So, hi, welcome everybody. We are now continuing with the talk by Kai Denker. Kai is currently making his, PhD, right? He's studying in philosophy, history, and informatics. So this will rather be not a completely technical talk, but more focus on history and the importance of stuff that happened. We'll just start. Please give a warm round of applause for Kai and go.
Thank you for this kind introduction and welcome to my talk, which was titled Does Hacktivism Matter? And as you may know, this talk is part of the track Society and Politics. And in fact, my talk will deal with society, politics, and even hacking. But does it work? No. Sollen wir das dann nehmen einfach? Okay. It's a talk about history, and in particular, the history of hacking and its impact on lawmaking. And to be honest, I'm not really a historian. My background is, as you have heard, in computer science and in philosophy, and I mostly work on the philosophical theories of digital movements, for example, hacktivism. So the history of the digital sphere, that's a history that is still extremely short, is an important basis of my work, but not its main focus. And as a basis for my work, I need to find examples for hacktivism that matters, or mattered at all, if there's such a thing. Okay. So this is my motivation. I want to know if hacktivism matters. And to answer this question, first I have to know what hacktivism means. And my preliminary definition is any kind of political activism that is performed by hacking. That is not digital activism, that is what we do in blogs or Twitter or something like that. It's precisely connected to hacking. And the second thing we have to know is when something matters, and that is when it has any impact outside the hacker movement itself, for example, in the political sphere, or in society, in law, and so on. So, what I'm going to do. First, I want to describe, before I describe the BTX hack itself, I will give you an idea what historians actually do. I want to give you an impression what this discipline is all about, how it works, and which questions I addressed in history and how the discipline itself developed very shortly. And after this crash course through history as a science, I will talk about the image of technology in the 1980s. It was when the computer age was about to leave its infancy and still was an alien fantasy that was far, far away for most people. Then I will give you an impression of the Bildschirmtext system, BTX, for short, which was an epitome of large, centralized technology in the 1980s. And finally, I will focus on the computer crime lawmaking in the 1980s to answer our question. Okay. What do historians do and why? History as a science developed in the late 19th century, and in the traditional view of history, it had to tell how it really was. And that meant mostly to reconstruct events and events in a political sense. But nowadays we have a broader scope in this subject. As a contemporary view of history is foremost to have more theory, to question own concepts, and to have a shift from mere events to power relations, and to question the role of history itself in producing legitimacy and identity. For example, history serves as a tool for building founding myth or to legitimize territorial demands, for example. And this is something that we have to question when we deal with history. Okay, how does historical research work? First, an idealized and generic idea of it. First of all, of course, you need a research question. And this research question defines what's your interest in literature, archives, and sources. And when you have found literature and sources, you have to think about this. And of course, it's an incremental process. when you have done enough incremental steps in this process, you can start, in theory, idealized writing, and then publish your paper, and then it becomes literature for history itself. Okay, this method is, of course, highly subjective. We have, first of all, the question, what is a source? How do we evaluate it? Then we have to know which literature there is. Is it relevant? Is it reliable? And which interpretation is appropriate? And this appropriateness is of interpretations is where the subjective bias of history, which is mostly conservative, by the way, is most obvious. But let's go to some real history and try to find out how it works in reality. First of all, we have problems in finding funding for exotic research questions. Today it's much easier, but a few years ago you had much more problems in getting funding for example, for gender history or something. And nowadays it's much more easy. And for example, my focus on the 1980s is something that is more or less trendy since a few years, but still very new to history. And the second problem is there is often very little literature for your topic you are dealing with, so you have to find it, and mostly there is nothing. And when you, for example, are dealing with hacktivism, you find a lot of literature written by hacktivists themselves, but you can't really use this as activist literature as literature in a scientific sense. There are sources. But when you're going to sources, you have, first of all, the problem to get to archives, and this is the accessibility of archives. For example, when I started searching for sources for this topic, I asked the Telecom if they had still left something about the BTX system. And I received an answer the other day, and it was just, oh, we don't support research. Okay, thank you. And I wrote the Bundesnetzagentur to find out if they had something, and they didn't answer at all. But some guy called me on the phone from the Fernmeldetechnische Zentrale in Darmstadt. That was a technical operator of BTX. And when I told what I was looking for, he said, oh, BTX was the only system that has never been hacked. Okay. It was a quite interesting phone call I had, but it was a dead end, too. Okay, so when you finally made it to find some archives who have material for you, in this case it is, of course, the archive of the German Bundestag, you have to use these sources and to question their reliability. And we will see that even sources from the Bundestag, from the Parliament's archive, are a bit tricky to work. And finally, if you have done all these things and can have thought enough and started writing, you always have to keep the reader in mind. And that means you have to follow dominant trends and discourses that are shaping your research too. For example, when I was working on this, the first idea was to write a paper on BTX. And then the editor asked me to expand this paper with consumer culture. And there was almost no sources for consumer culture on BTX. And so I decided to expand the scope of the paper to hacktivism in particular. And then they started, that's quite interesting, but we want an introduction into the history of the CCC. So I had to revise the paper again and again. But now it's hopefully done. I hope so. It's peer review. I have no idea if it gets accepted. So next step, we have found sources, but what is a source at all? And a source is, simply put, every authentic object that tells us something about the past. And we have, of course, some constraints with that. We have to understand the source. It's not trivial. We have, for example, a language problem. There are many sources from ancient times that we can't read because the language is just lost. I think the language is called Linear A, and we have no idea to translate it. Another problem is it must be comprehensible, and you must be able to talk about it. This is, for example, a problem if you're dealing with source code. When you try to use source code as a source for history, you get the problem that your reader won't understand it. I tried to give an idea of hacking culture in the early 80s in the paper and described a part of the first Datenschleuder, where Wolf Holland demanded to program a quine, a program which output equals a source code to become a member of the CCC. And I think it was a quite easy explanation about it. And the editor refuted that I should exclude it, no one would understand. Okay, so you need sources that are understandable by other historians, and that is often a hard thing. And we must be able to conserve our source, which means we cannot use feelings or memories. We can, of course, use time witnesses, but that is a problem because time witnesses have their own bias, they have their own individual memories of an event, and they tend to be interested in history too. Which means that you can interview a time witness about, for example, the end of the Second World War, and he will know a lot of details just because he has read historical books about it. And it's quite a bias, you can't use this source in many cases. Okay, so your research question shapes the definition of what a valid source is, and we have to think a bit more about that. And here in this talk, I will use mostly text as a source. I will exclude time witnesses. Okay, sources that are passed on. We can distinguish two types of sources. The first type is handed on by accident. That means that they are not created with the intention to be found and evaluated by historians. For example, shopping lists, that's an actual source, accounting docs, general communication like letters, orders, log files, and even diaries. And they are written without respect to history. The other type of source are intentionally passed on, and so they were created with historians in mind. That's mostly protocols, chronicles, inscriptions, for example, on headstones, which is a tremendously important source for ancient history. And of course, deeds. But if you think of the second type of, second type, you may have noticed you can counterfeit them, and so they are oolable. And I like this example very much. Maybe you can remember this famous speech of Hans-Peter Uhl in the Bundestag a few month ago, where he was actually saying, it's been recorded on video, that Germany is governed by security officials who are bound by the law. And when you get, when you look in the protocol, in the official protocol that will go to the archives, it reads, has security officials who are bound by the public law. And so you have to be very skeptic about that. And here in this case, this is a screenshot from the PDF file from the homepage, where it still is, wir haben Sicherheitsbeamte, we have. And I think I should speed up a bit with my time, so I won't show you the video, but look for it on YouTube. It's a soul speech where he is more or less lunatic and insane what he's talking about. Okay, so let's sum up this for a moment. Is history a science at all if we have all these problems? Yes, it is, but it's of course closely connected to common sense. It's a really big problem of history, and it's connected to political agendas. And therefore it's highly subjective. But on the other hand, we have a systematic public self-correction. That's crucial for most sciences. For example, if you think of esotericism, this discipline doesn't have this. Still, history has an empirical basis too, and therefore it is able to change its views and to develop. Okay, just by the way, can history then be a hacking tool for society, for example? After all, it is a tool for producing legitimacy and identity, and therefore if you start hacking on this to destroy, for example, legitimation or try to destroy identities, you could try to use history as a hacking tool, and actually this will work, but it's slow, it's very slow, and it's conservative. It's quite hard to make an impact in history with revolutionary ideas. But on the other hand, we have encouraging examples, for example, in queer and gender or women's history, where scholars try to show that our sexual norms are subject to history and not to an eternal form of morality or something. So, now we can rephrase our topic to get the question more precise and have a few questions to answer. First, what kind of hacktivism do we mean exactly? The second is, when does something matter exactly? Then, on which sources could we decide this, and where do we find such sources? And of course, we must not forget the historical context found in literature. Okay. This will be hacktivism. In this talk, will be the activities of the CCC in the early 1980s, and in particular, the BTX hack. The next is the criteria for matter, some impact on computer crime laws. So we have to look for sources about computer crime lawmaking and look if we find any traces about from the BTX hack, and we can of course look into the media too to see if we have some impact there. Okay, so sources are protocols from the German parliament, where lawmaking is documented, and of course publications from the CCC. Okay, part two. Now that we have a historical and theoretical basis for this, we can turn to historical context and look at technology and society in the 1980s. And there we found that technology in the 1980s was something between threat and fascination. And you must keep in mind that information technology back then was quite new for most of people, and it had just started to affect everyone's life. We had, for example, a connection to the peace movement in Germany. That's more or less specific for Germany. That's the Frankfurt School, with this idea that bureaucracy and the administered man would be speeded up by information technology and turn out to be a new form of fascism. And we have a huge discourse about large opaque centralized systems in many different areas, for example, military or nuclear energy and information technology. Think, for example, of the census, where we had this ruling of the Constitutional Court about the informational self-determination. And this was all connected to ideas that there is some anonymous, large, opaque system we don't understand where our data is collected and that can somewhat control our lives. And connected to this, we have, of course, the hacker ethic, where one sentence is to mistrust authorities and promote decentralizations. And if you connect this to this idea of large centralized systems, you will immediately see the idea that centralization and authority is closely connected and has therefore to be questioned. Okay, in this time we had also the Green Movement and then the Green Party, which is quite important because most of this skepticism about technology culminated in this movement, and we can see that the Green Party was quite, if you like, conservative against new technology back then. And when we try to analyze the political spectrum a bit more, we find, in a short story, first the Stalinist Marxist left, or the very, very orthodox left-wing radical parties that were technocratic and centralistic, all that technology has to fulfill, that is, technology must be controlled by the party, the Communist Party, and then technology is a good thing. Against that, we had the alternative movements, the Greens, where technocritic and decentralism was on the agenda. And against that, we had liberals and conservatives, which were more ambivalent. They emphasized the economic opportunities of technology, but still were a bit skeptic about that. Okay, and now try to place the early CCC in the spectrum. It's extremely hard to do because the level of political interest within the members of the early CCC is quite unclear. And mostly, they have been connected to each other through techno enthusiasm and not to a political agenda. And so they had, on the one hand, a complicated relationship to political parties, especially to the Greens, because the Greens were very technocritic, and the CCC very techno-enthusiastic. And so there was a large area for conflicts. For example, in the 1980s, the Bundestag decided to introduce information technology in the parliament, and the Green Party was the last party to adopt the system. And the CCC tried to support the Green Party in adopting information technology. And as far as I know, it was disappointing for the club to see that the Greens were only able to see information technology as an instrument of power and not as an instrument for enabling people to communicate or to do things. Okay, that's for a very short as a historic background. And now to part three, hacking Bildschirmtext. Okay, as I told you, I will use the protocols of the Committee for Legal Affairs. It's a bit, this text is wrong. Okay, next slide. Sorry. Okay, let's go to Bildschirmtext. This was more or less, if you like, an epitome of information technology, but what was Bildschirmtext? BTX was a communication information system that has been developed in the 1970s and deployed in the 1980s, and it has very many different brands. In Germany, it was BTX, in the UK, Prestel, and Minitel in France. And if you go outside to the not the cash desk, the angel desk, the help desk in the middle of the room, behind the glass, you will find a Minitel appliance standing there doing things, if you like to see an appliance like this at work. And BTX was operated by the Deutsche Bundespost, which was the telecommunication monopolist back at the time, and the technical operation was in Darmstadt at the Fernmeldetechnisches Zentralamt. And the target of the system was consumers and companies for communications and e-commerce. So pretty much, if you like, a very early primitive version of the internet with some differences, as we will see on another slide. Okay. Now, what did it look like? You had something like this, a very primitive screen formula to enter your identification codes. The first identification code BTX number couldn't be changed. This is a part of the BTX sector change this number. And if you entered the BTX system, you had have pages like this, where you could access other pages with numbers you had to type into your terminal. It's mostly like the teletext system some TV sets still have. And the appliances looked more or less like this. You had more or less two different types of devices. This was a standalone device, but you can also have setup boxes for your TV sets and later on decoder cards for your computer. So it's something about its technical properties, as I said before, it is mostly like the teletext system, and it was quite slow. We had only 1,200 bits per second in the beginning. And it had a different topology in comparison to the internet. First of all, it clearly distinguished client-server, had a central mainframe that was in the city of Ulm, and a distributed database server system, all IBM machines, and consumer devices, mostly connected to TV sets. And by the way, you had different roles, information providers and subscribers, and so you had different end-user devices for both roles. And if you wanted to added BTX pages, you needed a much more expensive device for information providers. Or you just could simply use the cheaper device and drill two holes in it, because it was actually the same hardware, just with two buttons less installed. Okay, the system could perform simple animations and had a micro payment system. This is also crucial for the BTX sec. And this is, excuse me for the quality, it's about the proliferation of BTX. And as you see, the post was quite optimistic about the proliferation of BTX, and this was the reality. I really love this graphic. And for example, in 1987, the Greens filed a questionnaire in the Bundestag to get more information about this failure. And in his response, the Minister for Post and Telecommunications had to admit that out of 400,000 BTX sets that has been ordered in 1981, only 58,000 has been sold end of 1986. So it was, as a matter of fact, an economic failure and a catastrophe. Okay, but some people were buying the sets, and mostly not consumers. These were reluctant. Mostly it was the CCC, of course, that were eager to use, other technical enthusiasts, of course, too. And the CCC had, of course, its own service on BTX, which was which consisted in information pages and a donation page. You could access this page to donate some money to the CCC, and it was, as far as I know, some fun for some people to go to public BTX terminals and to access this donation page, billing, I think, the post for it or something, somebody else, but not yourself. So the second reason for the CCC to use BTX was to highlight problems, for example, in data protection and security. And this is all the BTX hack is about. And of course, the Bundespost, who tried to sell their devices, tried always to downplay this, such findings. So we have this conflict on the one hand, the CCC trying to highlight data security problems, and the Bundespost trying to sell the devices on the other hand. So that was the context of the BTX hack. And so we can start to tell a story. First of all, for the BTX hack, you had to get somebody else's identification codes. And that was the HASPA, the Hamburger Savings Bank. And then you had to modify your BTX decoder set. Originally, it wasn't possible to enter somebody else's ident codes, but if you removed the ROM chip in which the ident code was programmed, this device just asked you for your new identification code. And of course, it was not legal to open this box. And on a conference for data security in 1984, Paul Horner demonstrated how to open this box without breaking its seal. And the post, of course, was not amused about that and denied the possibility for a time. Okay, so after modifying your BTX decoder set for faking the HASPA's identity, you can access your own donation page automatically. And in this case, it means they had obtained, I think it was 135,000 marks in one night. And if you are an evil hacker, this is your money. And if you're a good hacker, you can report yourself to the Data Protection Commissioner the other day. And then your achievement, you get a lot of attention and embarrass your arch nemesis, in this case, the Bundespost. I think OpenOffice just crashed. Did you program that? Yeah. Give me a second. No, LaTeX. I think I know what the reason is. This presenter plugin I use cannot work with videos. Great. So the money transfer of 135,000 marks wasn't between actual bank accounts. It was, of course, between BTX accounts. So the HASPA would have become a phone bill of 135,000 marks by the Bundespost. And so you see, it was quite hard, would have been quite hard to gain the money at all, because the HASPA would just have refused to pay the bill. But the interesting question is, how did they obtain the ID codes to do the hack? And the CCC version is that there was a security flaw in BTX. And the Bundespost had another version that Holland and Veneri, who carried out the hack, observed the ident codes during a public demonstration. And actually, there's no possibility from the perspective of a historian to decide this question. We don't just have the sources about that. And if you want to know the truth, try to ask Veneri. And of course, as you remember, it's a type 2 source, more or less. It's his memories. And you can't be totally sure if he's telling the truth, of course. Okay, let's have a look at the Haspa's reaction on the BTX hack. Normally, you would see a video on the left side, but I can't see can't show it. That was Benno Schulemann, the Haspa manager, who was talking about the diligence of these people. And he was opinion that one could not stress enough how regrettable it was that the Post couldn't be convinced before this evidence produced by these people that its BTX software does not fulfill all requirements. It's quite polite to say it this way, but I think it's a quote showing how activism evolved in Germany. If this bank had pressed charges against Holland and Veneri, the press reports would have been quite different. Okay, more details on the reaction on the BTX hack. We have seen the Haspa manager expressing his respect for the hackers, and the most of the media cheered for them, of course, revealing data protection flaws. You can even look, for example, in the Bild-Zeitung. It's a tabloid paper, if you're not from Germany. And even the Bild-Zeitung was quite cheerful for Holland and Veneri. In comparison with Finland. I think it's because of a David versus Goliath scenario here. But of course, the Bundespost tried to downplay the hack. And first, they admitted the possibility to obtain ident codes without observing them somewhere else to a security flaw, which was more or less a buffer overflow hack. We don't need to get into the details here. But then they denied the seriousness of the hack and told it was more about the same probability to win in the lottery to have some codes like this obtained. So obviously, as the Bundespost told in letters to its employees, excuse me, the Haspa has been just careless. And this was a discussion in the media back then, and the first result was that the Committee of Post and Telecommunications blamed the Bundespost for its clumsy communication politics to have admitted the possibility of the hack at first. That was the short story of the BTX hack. And now let's come to the last part about computer crime lawmaking and the water. So my aim at this part of my talk is to trace the BTX hack here, and particularly to do this in the protocols of the Committee for Legal Affairs, the Rechtsausschuss of the German Bundestag. And you can find these protocols in the archives of the German Parliament, the Parlamentsarchiv. And anyone who has a scientific interest in the sources can access them, but you will have to wait up to 12 years to access them. The source has to be so old to get it. And nowadays, most older protocols of the committee are edited on microfiche, something like microfilm, but you won't get the full story out of them. They're just the protocols. But if you want to read all the letters and notes exchanged between the Ministry of Justice and the committee, so you have to go to the parliament itself. And actually, they are quite nice there, but you have always a watchdog at your side. There was this really nice middle-aged lady who sat in the archive room. I was the only person to use the archive, and when I went to the restrooms, she followed me, waited before the door, and then we could go back to the archive itself. It was quite weird. And oh, by the way, they don't have Wi-Fi there, so bring your mobile card. Okay, let's go to the computer crime lawmaking itself. Around the end of the 1970s, lawmakers in the industrialized states became aware that existing laws didn't fit the dawning information age. And this was especially true for the criminal code. And And we tend to think that the criminal code is an example for legal positivism, which denies the existence of crimes that are not codified by written law. But however, in this case, we could think of the criminal code as some kind of codified natural law that expresses some kind of condemnation. And so the idea was that there was, in fact, crimes that were not addressed by the existing criminal code. So stakeholders discussed a phenomena like computer fraud and, for example, a crime that didn't fit under any existing law, as they said. And so they demanded the codification of computer crimes and hence a penalization of such behavior. Yep. Yes, that's typical problems, tapping data too. And they had quite interesting questions in this context. For example, a fraud means to make a human err about something, to give him false information, but a computer cannot err. A computer is always right in this sense. And so the traditional law couldn't address this. Another problem was that results of calculations are no legal deeds. In the German law system, a deed is virtually every written document that can be used as evidence in court. But the law system wants that this document can be read with your eyes. And of course, calculations on a hard disk, for example, cannot read with your eyes. So changing calculations there are not a crime, according to the old law. That was a problem about that. So, about 1980, the lawmaker started to negotiate the Zweites Wirtschaftskriminalitätsbekämpfungsgesetz, which wanted to address fight white collar crimes, such as some uninteresting economic crimes like fraud in the social system, something like that, but especially computer fraud, quantifying deeds, and tapping data, destroying data or programs. And this asterisk is marked crimes wasn't a part of the original bill what entered in the negotiations, as we will see. And the necessity of this new law was not disputed by any political party. Only the Greens were skeptical about introducing new laws into the criminal code, but they hadn't any other idea, actually. So let's have a look at the bill in detail. And it started with a draft from the Ministry of Justice, which only included, as I said, computer fraud and counterfeiting digital deeds, or actually changing data. And after hearing the committee hold with stakeholders from they extended and revised the bill. The stakeholders, of course, were from industry and law enforcement, and not hackers or consumers or something like that. So they had actually the chance to submit their personal wish list without any opposition. And here they demanded the introduction of norms for tapping or destroying data. A bit more detail, if you like. For example, this is a problem with 202 STGB. STGB is a German criminal code. The traditional law only applied to letters with an envelope, and files on the hard disk do not have an envelope, so you need a new law for this. Another example is, as I already explained, the computer fraud, and the unauthorized data change, because destroying material things always applied only on material things, not on digital data, which was actually just altered, not destroyed, if you like. Okay, so in this discussion we find a nice definition of hacking in the communication between the ministry and the committee. You find a letter explaining the draft from the ministry, and it's a really nice explanation. A person fulfills the elements of the offense if he or she overcomes access guards, for example, by repeatedly typing combinations of letters and numbers on the keyboard of a home computer, hacking, and as such gains access to data not designated to be accessed by this person. But no, let's have a closer look at discussions inside the committee. And as I said, they had concerns about the necessity to extend the scope to meet the stakeholders' wishes, of course, and to discuss some other details of newly filed by the Ministry of Justice. But on the October 23rd, 1985, that's the most important session of the community in this case, they first agreed on the revised draft, but then we find a footprint of the BTX hack, more on this later. Oh, by the way, we have two 23s in this case. And to get back to the other slide, the Ministry of Justice had a clear idea of hacking. It was had no noteworthy technological skills and was a mere trial and error by entering guest passwords. But then the committee considered that maybe we should exempt good hackers and young computer enthusiasts from punishment for their beneficial work. And the members of the community were impressed by hacks in which hobbyists proved large companies and organization security measures to be insufficient. And then we have one case in which two members of a computer club managed to transfer a large amount of money from a bank to their own account using BTX, thus providing that the DBP security guarantee was false. This is the actual place where the BTX hack was discussed in the committee, and even the conservatives agreed. They sympathized with the hackers and were impressed by their intellectual discipline. Nice to hear that, isn't it? Oh, by the way, this is a signature of the document in the archive of the parliament. I think it's quite nice. They have always long lists of numbers to address certain committees in different periods of the lawmaking periods and so on. I don't know whoever has built this ident codes must be drunk or something. Okay, we had different opinions. Oh, it's a nice typo. In the comedy, first of all, it was just a hobby, and we had to limit this hobby to a justifiable extent. And of course, 202A STGB was so an inevitable part of the new legislation. But data protection issues should be a legal excuse. But on the other hand, I couldn't find a legal definition of politically correct hacking. So they tried to find another way. And try this. They reshaped 202A STGB in the draft to make punishable tapping data, of course, but only data that is protected by some protection mechanism. And not punishable, merely logging in, breaking protection mechanisms, as long as no data is obtained. So, think of your favorite authentication protocol. As soon as the server acknowledges your login attempt, you have to enter connection and you handle problem. But this was actually no hacking, if you like. So, for example, you could think that even displaying the prompt was some kind of tapping an environment variable of the system. Okay, but this version was submitted by the committee and adopted by the parliament in 1986, and the law became a real law, working law. So, it was, of course, discussed in law journals. And there we have the idea of a good hacker, too, of course. For example, with Mr. Hafte, who was a law professor at some university, who maintains the impunity of hobbyist hackers by discussing the new law. And a person most of us know, at least by name, some guy called Gravenreuth distinguished in an article between hackers, crackers, and crashers. So the law people tried hard to make some sense of the discussion in the committee. And all these attempts evidently were silenced. So in 2007, Ernst underlined that these attempts had virtually no effect in telling good hackers from bad hackers in practice. And in a new computer crime law, I think 2006, the idea that only logging in without tapping data should be free was revised, and since then, logging in is a crime too. So, of course, the law has had some impact in hacktivism too. And in hackers' literature, for example, in the case computer book, I think it's called, we have the idea that it was a law against hacking, or was it a law only aimed at real white collar crimes with collateral damage with hackers? And however, it was seen as a kind of a tariff list for hacking, How expensive is it to hack? How long have to go for jail for something? And the conclusion was, if you wanted to keep hacking, you had virtually to hack the law yourself, the law itself, to find ways for legal hacking. Okay, let's come to the conclusion. History, as a science and as a tool for hacking a society, is slow and conservative. Yet we have sometimes surprising results in the long run. And on the other hand, history of hacking is still in its infancy, and there's a lot more to do to work on this part. Second is, the BTX system was an epitome of the 1980s technology, which combined expectations and fears and was one place of effective hacktivism that mattered. And hacktivism indeed changed the law by changing images, by creating the image of the good hacker, which was something between a consumer protector and a data protection officer, and yet it was marginalized in discussions as being a mere hobby. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks so far, Kai. We have now comfortable 15 minutes for Q&A sessions. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and I'll come with the microphone to you. And we'll switch between questions from the IRC and people here in the room.
Could you explain in some more detail the difference between the consumer version of the BTX device and the author's version? You spoke of two keys missing. Is this the extent?
Yeah. Okay, the question was about the difference between the consumer device for BTX and the provider device. As far as I know, I had no chance to play around with the hardware myself. The only difference was that there were actually two buttons more or less more installed at the provider version. So you only had to open the device, drill holes in it, and to install additional buttons to löten auf Englisch? To solder the buttons to the main board, and that was pretty much it.
Thanks for this nice overview of the history of the CCC and especially on the BTX and history of hacking laws in Germany. I'd challenge you and bring a different definition of hacktivism that mm-hmm. doesn't sort of only conclude hacking, that has legal consequences, but is limited to using hacking to achieve a political goal. Mm-hmm. Of course, the history of hacktivism in that sense is also very short, but do you have any information on this? So do you see the BTX hack as hacktivism in the sense that it was done to achieve a political goal, or was this just a side effect of the BTX hack?
Actually, I think the goal of the BTX hack was to leave political footprints. I just think that Holland and Renary had no clue that there was such a tremendous effect in the political sphere. It was more or less an attempt to let their arch nemesis meet its Waterloo, if you like. And when it turned out that they gained so much attention for the BTX hack, they maybe, I don't know for sure, changed their mind and tried to exploit the political effect.
Okay, any more questions? Okay, if we don't have any more questions, please give a huge round of applause for Kai for his talk.